I would like to welcome up Ms. Stacy K.
Gosh, I brought my podium and my notes. I got a whole lot more to say than the doctor, so I hope everybody's comfortable for the next few minutes. What is character? It is the mental and moral qualities distinctive to an individual. So it's your personality, your temperament, your disposition, your mental makeup. So let's be honest for just a minute and let's have no rules. And if just for a second, we agree that we don't have to be perfect, we're just gonna be real. I was conceived by 17 and 15-year-old teenagers back in 1972. And as you can imagine, back in 1972, two teenagers pregnant, that wasn't accepted. So you did one of two things. You either went and you lived in a home with a bunch of other women that were pregnant, and you were there 9 months, and they put your baby up for adoption. And you then left, and you went home back to your life, never seeing your child again. Or else you ended up in the closest, biggest city that performed abortions. I fortunately was saved. My mother was 15 years old. She went to my grandmother on a Sunday afternoon, said that she was pregnant. My grandmother then told my grandfather, and he made plans to take her to Memphis, Tennessee. That was the closest, nearest, biggest city that performed abortions. My mother agreed that she would marry my father so that they could keep me. So on January the 2nd of 1973, I was born. I will tell you that it was not easy being a child to a teenager. My mother dated often. She had drug use and alcohol use. So you can imagine, rather than being a family, I became more of a counselor to her. And I learned to help people at a young age. My mom and dad's marriage lasted about 18 months when they got a divorce. But I had some stability in my life because my grandparents on both my mother and father's side, they practically raised me. So I turned out with some sort of sense, I like to think. When I turned 7 years old, my mother married my stepfather, and she thought that she had met the love of her life. And gone were the days of the trailer park because we moved into this beautiful home, the largest in the neighborhood with a swimming pool. And my mother and stepfather decided when I was 9 years old that they would take in a 17-year-old boy. He had got caught smoking pot in school and been kicked out of his house. And so at 9 years old, I was sexually abused by him. I suppressed the incident. I didn't tell anyone. I didn't have the vocabulary because I was nine. I mean, I'd never even kissed a boy. I'd never had a crush. I'd never held hands with anyone. So you can imagine, I didn't know what to say. I remember telling my mother that I didn't like him and that he was mean to me, but for the most part, she reassured me that he would never do anything to hurt me. Then, shortly after, I found myself now living in Cedarville, Arkansas. We've moved away from that small town, and for the most part, my parents, they'd gotten their lives back in church, and I had a good life, believe it or not, after that incident. I went on to graduate high school with a normal life. I was voted most popular by the who's who. I was the school clown at school, so if there's some sort of normalcy to high school, I feel like I fit in there. But shortly after, I found myself graduating and in Missouri living with my grandmother, and I was in beauty school. And I found out that I was pregnant myself as a teenager at 19 years old. So on June the 2nd of 1992, I gave son to my son Chase sitting over there. And I got to tell you, we had the same struggles. The cycle had continued on from my mother to me. And so living off food stamps and WIC and Medicaid and HUD housing and all the things that you can imagine that the government offers us to make life a little bit easier, that's what Chase and I endured. By the time that I was 21 years old, I had begun making some sort of living, being a hairstylist in the salon, had a crush on a police officer in town. And he would frequent the salon, and as he gained my trust and shared with me how miserable he was in his marriage and how he wished his wife would be like me, Eventually, about a year into that on again, off again relationship or crush or whatever you would want to call it, he showed up to my house one night late in his patrol car, and I was 22 years old when he raped me. Once again, I never told anyone. I began to think that I was damaged and that nobody would accept me. And right before my eyes, being a single parent, my life began to fall apart. Just like a script, I was playing the role of this child riddled with a sexual past, and it was broken. So I decided at 24 years old that I was sick and tired of being sick and tired, and I started some counseling. That's when I sat down with the counselor, and she asked me to fill out a questionnaire that I took, and I discovered at that point in time, at 24 years old, that I had been sexually abused, and I admitted for the first time that I had been raped. I could see that my character was defined by my past. And although I wasn't ready to share all of these truths with anyone because I was ashamed and embarrassed, I had become a victim. I have to tell you, there was some sort of normalcy that I felt by this point because I felt like someone understood me. I met my husband 2 years after I started therapy. Man, I thought life was perfect. I thought, you know, I've recognized this damaged child that grew into this victim that was a character, and that I could, for the most part, get married and become a mother to my son, Chase. And we moved away from that little small town in Arkansas. That's how I ended up here at Victoria, Texas. And so I thought life was wonderful. But on December the, in 2009, my mother called me and my son and my daughter, Jaden. She was born here at Citizens, called us into the living room, and he announced that he was having an affair with another woman. And I gotta tell you, at that point in time, life got real. You see, I'd become so cold back in Arkansas. My character, it was based on this childhood of sexual abuse and this rape and abortions and drugs and alcohol, that I had came here and thought that I had found a new beginning. But that's when my life got real. Because even though I began to rebuild myself and I began to go back and I would read scripture and I would study the Word of God, I just wasn't quite there yet. I'd found my husband when I was damaged, and I was searching for something to see me. I felt invisible, something to make me complete and whole. I began to make it a conscious effort that I would put forth all my energy that I had to rebuild myself from the inside out. And I began to journal. Back in my 20s at that counseling appointment, my counselor told me you need to write everything out. You know, if I could write it out, if I could read it, then I could accept it, I could see it. It would release itself from my body, mind, and soul. So now at 33 years old, I had been writing for, I don't know, 15 years of my life, 12 years of my life at that point in time. So when my husband left me, I fell on my hands and knees, and I literally cried out to God. I thought, you know, if I'm embarrassed and I'm humiliated, I'm fixing to lose it all. So I'm going to turn it over to God. At this point in time, I don't have any more power over my life. So I called on some friends, and they came to my rescue. You can imagine, I was here in Victoria. My family was 750 miles away. I didn't have a job. I left the salon to be a stay-at-home mom and raise Chase and Jaden. I had $42,000 in debt in my name. My husband had taken everything in our bank account. I literally found myself broke. But I knew that what I had done is I had changed my character, because the victim that I was from the sexual past had changed, and I had renewed myself. I had became new again. I'm here to tell you that whether you're standing here with me right now at National AIDS Awareness Day, or whether you're fighting a disease yourself, that there's nothing by chance or coincidence. I know that I married that man, because had I not, I wouldn't have got to Victoria. I wouldn't have given birth to my daughter. I wouldn't have made the connections, the spiritual connections that I have in my life. And I'd have probably never written that book. I went back to that journal and I began to read about a little girl that was damaged and broken. I thought, man, I don't want to be her. I want to be somebody new. And as I continued to read, what I had written about were 10 character commitments. You'll find them in that book. We've brought in several copies. If you know someone that you can pay them forward and pass them along, please do. But when I got here, now with no job, the Stalings, friends of mine, they'd given me a check for $350. They said, this isn't a loan, it's an investment. We want you to take it, go get your cosmetology license renewed, and build a life in Victoria, Texas. And that's what I did. I got hired on with Joe Anthony Pena at Hair Dimensions. It was a hairdresser's dream, let me tell you. International Platform Artist of the Year. People pay to work for Joe, but he had hired me. That opened up another door, because then I found myself cutting commercials at 95.1, 104.7, right now, with Joe Fryer. And Joe Fryer decided that he liked me so much, I guess this loudmouth Southern girl that was opinionated, that he'd keep me on. And so he said, if you'll come back on Tuesdays and Thursdays, well, then we'll keep you here. And he gave me the name Stacy Kay, and he called me the relationship expert. After that, I went on to meet this man behind me, local celebrity brother Gary Moses. And in that moment, my life began to change. I found myself hosting barbecue cook-offs. I felt like I knew everybody in town, you know. I thought I was the only girl that Brother Gary kissed, but now that I've followed him around and spent some time with him, I know he kisses every woman in the audience. So I didn't know what God had done for me, but I knew that I'd also been given a place at GC Magazine. I now get to share my insight with over 30,000 readers in the Crossroads. I get to talk about character. I didn't know that when I decided to take my dream to YouTube, that I was going to share my story of sexual abuse and rape and my transformation from victim to survivor. I didn't know that Ashley Paul, who was a client of mine, had been sitting in my chair the whole time. So when I started to share with her my vision, she was able to give me guidance to protect my intellectual property and my conceptual idea. I did not know that when I started writing those journals, that they would contain two books. My first book, Be Beautiful Being You, and my second book, The 10 Character Commitments. I did not know that when I met Jennifer Price, the nation's religion reporter, at judging a pageant in Cuero, she asked to write my story. That was the most read, most talked about faith story of the year. She also became the editor of both of my books. I did not know that I would become a franchise owner and be the CEO of the only brand in the world for survivors. We are called Just Us, and we pray it out, write it out, speak it out. You see, I had changed myself. I had recognized the pessimistic, hateful, blaming victim that I was. And I had changed my life and given glory to God. And because of that, He began to change everything around me. I hope you pick up a copy of the book. I talk about compassion, an act of kindness which shows empathy and expresses love. The spirit. That's the essence of who you are. Happiness. Look for the good in everyone and everything. Perseverance. When things seem so difficult, You don't think you can find a way, you've got to find a way to continue. Words, that's the vessel that describes you. Integrity, to be true to yourself and recognize your faults and failures with humility. Forgiveness, letting go of the pain and the shame. Being humble, every interaction with someone else is a teaching tool. Courage, believing that you can do all things that you can imagine. And confidence, my favorite, the way that you think of yourself is crucial. I don't know why I was brought here tonight. I know that Sky gave me the opportunity, and she knows I talk a lot about sexual abuse because I believe that that's what I was brought here to do, live and survive something so that I could help change another person, so that I could allow them to release from the shackles and chains and be set free. But thank you for the opportunity. I hope that we all take from this that we are not defined by our values, but by our integrity. Decide what you're worth, and then test the principles in your mind again and again and again, and have a self-reflection. If you don't know who you are and what's going on in your life, I guarantee you, you can look around you, the company that you keep, because like attracts like, and character attracts character. And if you don't like who you're with, then you need to dig deep in your soul and figure out what it is about you that you need to change. Last but not least, I just want to share one last thing. When we share ourselves with others, we become a light to heal another person's soul. Thank you.